New project. We can deploy the WCF services in three ways. One is the web hosting. You can say IIS hosting. The second one is a Windows hosting. Third one is a self hosting. Okay. When we talk about Windows hosting, or you can say Windows hosting, nothing but I can create a DLA and I can register that DLA in my administrative tool service part. So that service will work as a WCF Windows service. And when we talk about self hosting, nothing but once you WCF service, just execute the exe part. Okay, it will be become as a hosting only. I'll show you that one also. And the third one would be IIS hosting. So let's start with we'll start with the WCF service application. So WCF service clip. See, when we talk about let me open with the notepad as well. Notepad. Our Windows service is hosting types. I'm talking about hosting modes.
Okay.
First is the Windows hosting. Second would be the hosting. Third would be IIS hosting. So whenever we talk about Windows hosting, there are two things involved in the Windows hosting. First would be the DLL. Second would be the EXE program, whatever EXE you have. The self hosting, when we talk about self hosting in that case, self hosting means create was DLL. Let me mute to everyone. Self hosting means create a WCF DLL. That's sufficient. When we talk about IIS hosting, you have to choose WCF service application. Nothing but a combination of the Windows and self hosting. Means the DLL I can use it, and EXE is not required because this is a web application or web service. So we can go any one of them, but most priority you have to go with the IIS hosting because everybody is using it. Now, we'll go with that first. These are the two things. This is the I service. This is the implementation. I service is nothing but an interface. If you wanted to, because WCF is the communication happening between the client and server, that only you can do with the interfaces. Interface is nothing but a contract for transferring the data from one machine to another machine. So if you wanted to expose a class, you have to use a service contract. If you are working with the web services, ASMX web service, you wanted to expose your class, then you have to use a web service attribute over there, nothing else. But in the WCF, if you want to expose a particular interface, you have to use a attribute called a service contract. In the web service, if you wanted to expose a method on the web, in the WCF you have to mention as a operation contract. In the web services, we call as a web method. So these are the two things which I mentioned. First is the, okay, there is one more thing. types of contracts. The types of contracts means interviewer will also asking in the WCF how many types of contracts in WCF. The first is the service contract. Second is the operation contract. The third is we can call as a data contract. Fourth would be a message contract. And the last one is a fault contract. You can get any number of examples from the Google itself for the WCF services. If you learn any one of them, service contract and operation contract or the data contract would be sufficient. Tell you the details in data contract and message contract as well. Okay, then you can search the Google and get some examples. Or if you are not able to understand, let me know. I'll do the sample from my end. Okay. So what is the use of the service contract? If you wanted to expose an interface to outside the world, you have to use this attribute as a service contract. If you wanted to expose your method, you have to use an operation contract. The third one is the data contract. What type of data you are going to expose? What type of entity you are going to expose? You have to use a data contract on top of the class. Message contract, it's almost same with the data contract, but the difference is when the client sends a data to the server, the data should be in the message format. Because the client and server will only understand the messages, not the data. But you can also do it with the data contract. But the most preferred way for data transferring, you have to go with the message contract. But you can also do with the data contract. But the problem is with the data contract, it's not giving you the full security on the classes. But when you go with the message contract, you can specify the security by using some bindings, WSS HTTP binding. The next one is the fault contract. It means if any exception occurs in the server side, the client will never understand what type of exceptions happening or what type of exceptions occurring on the server. He cannot identify. He will not get anything, whether you use a try catch block or anything. So if you wanted to specify some specific actual exceptions to the client, then you have to create one class and we can say as a fault contract. It's fault contract, nothing but we say in the try catch block or the exception handling, throws or custom exceptions, is similar to that custom exceptions. You have to use it. So just remember for the interview purpose as well, whenever some people will ask how many types of contracts, we do have five types: service contract, operation contract, data contract, message, and the fault contract. So for now, I created one service which have an attribute service contract. The method would have operation contract. If you see in the below side, if you wanted to expose a data of a particular entity, you have to put that as a data contract. But the data contract will not give you the security. If you wanted to use that, in that case, you have to go with message contract. Now let's see. Let me run it one second. See, this is the iService interface, or you can click service1.svc. I clicked on service1.svc, you will find. svcutil.exe is used for generating a metadata at the client side. If you wanted to see the particular description, what the service is exposing you, you can see it here. There are two methods predefined. The first is the get data, just copying it. Control F, Control V. See, everything is appending with the message text. Input message, output message. Everywhere you can see it. Everything is getting exposed because the client and server only can communicate with the messages only. That is why the WSDL is itself indicates the get data underscore input message or the output message. Means data get be transferred in the message format only. So it's not relevant for now for us right now, but the most important part is what is the URL of the service. Right now this is a normal service and the extension for the service is service1.svc. Let me copy this URL. I'm not closing the browser right now. See, means service is still running. Go to the Visual Studio, or you can consider I created this service and I can deploy this service in IIS. Okay, so once you deployed it IIS, you will get this URL. I'm just copying the URL, going to the our project, whether you are working with the MVC or .NET Core or any technology. What I am doing, just right clicking on to the website. You need to choose. See, if the service is normal old ASMX web service, in that case you should go with the web reference. If it is a WCF service, you should go with the add service reference. Click on it. Specify your URL. Click on go. Now I am by the service post. Whatever the methods you have, you can specify it here itself. Now, I'm just giving us some reference. For example, this is a user service reference. User service. Click on OK. Expanding this one, you will find few files over there. SVC information. This is nothing but a related to what service you have exposed, what is the endpoint for that, and you can just see three things here, ABC. What we discussed yesterday, this is, sorry. This is the address. See, this is the address still here. The binding, the B stands for which binding you are going to use it. The default binding is basic HTTP binding. The next one is a contract. Contract means what I am going to expose. It's an interface showing me iService 1. These are the three most important things in the WCF. Whenever you are developing the WCF services, you have to consider these three points, and then you can use it. Now, I'm going to use in direct in the application. I'm creating one page, add new item. I'll just write consume web service or consume WCF. Click on it. I'm placing one button, simple. At a laptop. Placing a break button here. Going to the design, I'm just double clicking on it. Simple. The reference you have added, that's a user service. I'm just writing on the button click. User service dot. What was the client? Service client. The interface and the class which you have created, that was a service one. If you see to the project, is the interface. This is our class. Where it is? This. So you have to create an object of the service class. So what I did, I'm using user service dot the service client. SVC OBJ, or I can just put as service client equals to new. Service client dot, see I am getting the methods here, get data, whatever, or I can put in. I can capture this value where str data equals to, then response, I am just printing here, dot write str data. Let's run it, then we can understand. I'll show you the other thing. Start page. Still service is running. Click on button. See, you entered a 10, whatever the data you have passed it. This is the basic example of WCF service. I have not created anything till now. Now, let's see and create one service here. And just remember one thing. This is a default service. I can create my own service. I'm just adding one more, one interface here. Add new item. Okay, let me write it from my, or you can just see. I user, user repository. Created one interface. Public interface. I'm writing one code here. If you wanted to expose this interface to the client, I have to set an attribute called service contract. I click on it, resolve. You have to import the namespace using system.service model. I used it. I'm creating one method. Now you guys tell me, we already have gone through some things how we can return the data to the user. If you remember, we did in the ADO.NET, we are creating some classes like user response.
Hello sir.
Yes Tushar. See.
Sorry sir. Actually kya hota hai in moment pe laptop pe jaldi start nahi hota
hai. No worry. We have not done anything till now. No worry. Okay. See, this is the user's response class which we have created. Now I am just creating some properties. Okay. Create one interface for now. This is the real implementation which we have already did it. Public interface, I'm just creating a response, I response, where I'm just, this is a generic interface, which I'm just specifying some parameters. Public string is success, sorry, error message something, I'm just writing, error message, put get sent. When you start working with web APIs, try to make an habit, do like this only. Public string bool, we already did, if you remember guys, is success. I can create number of properties here, but what I need actually, I need error message or is success, the result is coming from the service is true or false, based on that I can do it, right? If if success is failure, then you can display the error message based on the requirement. Now I have created one class, user response, inheriting from iResponse. I'm creating some number of properties here itself. Control C. Just writing user name, whatever. Control C. Control V. I'm creating something password. It should not be password. You can consider email. Okay. Or I can put it as email ID. Or user ID. I have inherited this interface here. I need to implement it, right? Interface. I implemented it. Okay. This is the properties which we were doing right now. This is nothing but we called as a automatic properties, where you don't need to write the code for that. Just use like this. I created it. Created one interface here itself, iRepository, and I'm creating one interface with the return type would be user response. I'm just writing get user details, and it is expecting me something, some data. I ask a user ID, it should return me a data related to a user details. So what you need to do, either you can just create integer user ID, but in future what happens, there is a requirement for putting some more conditions. If I pass a user ID, I'll get the details, but there is a future requirement, you need to validate user ID along with some other parameters like user ID or something, email ID. Or I can create one more method here itself, just copying it, paste it, the detail I'm writing, instead of searching with the user ID, or I can make it as get user detail by ID, something. Here I'm just writing a code for get user details, string email ID. I wanted to search a record for by using an email ID. That's true, I can do it. If there are multiple conditions, so what should I do now? Tell me, guys. Conditions means I wanted to search a record based on some, you can say, user details by using some account number and the first name. I wanted to apply some search functionality based on first name and the city. So first name, I can get a number of people who is having the same first name and the cities also. So do I need to create number of arguments, number of parameters? I can do one thing. Can I create, just like I created a user response, can I create a class which is taking as, I created a user response, I can create one more class here itself, which will contain some request parameters. I'll write user request. That's it. What are the parameters I needed? This one, I wanted to search a record based on email ID. I wanted to search a record based on some first name or address, public string. Just make it as a well, city. To search a record based on this requirement. This is the user request. Can I put it, put this here also? User request, user. Getting it? I can use it like this. So instead of creating a number of methods, searching the based on the email ID, and then later on I need to search a record based on some other parameters. Okay. So we have to pass a generic class, a class which will have some parameters, email ID or city. You can pass these parameters. Based on that, you can put your conditions. I'm creating a user repository now. Now, we'll go with the implementation. I created a user repository, needs to implement this thing in a particular class. So I'll create the class here itself. Or we can do one thing. Okay. I'll create a class here itself. Public class, class user details, user details. Inherit the interface by using a iUser repository. Right click on it, implement interface. Now here you can write your logic, whatever we did with the ADO.NET. I'll show you the entity framework in MVC, not here, but you can do it here itself if you want.
Okay,
but for now you can write your code by using ADO.NET here itself. Okay, so pull records, even not only I'm talking about the pull records, you can submit the data. So instead of creating this particular method, what I can do, just copying, pasting it, and I can write add user, something like that. I can create one more class which will have a request, user request. I'll just put it here, something like user. I can put a here properties here itself, or you can say I can put user add request. I can create number of parameters. This is the username. Going here, add user. Okay, just remove it once again. Right click on it, implement interface. Write a code for here itself. Okay, then get the user detail or something. Here now, for example, I'm just going for pulling the data from the database. What I'll do? This particular class is returning me a data in form of user response. So what I'll do, first I'll create a user response class. The way I'm creating an object, if you can do the same way, that would be really nice. Equals to user response. Pull the data from the database, whatever we did in the ADO.NET, and get the data and bind the data here itself. So I'm just writing hard-coded values for now, abc.com. abc.com something. And other data as well. Name is. And I can return this object from this method. Paste. I did it. Now let's build it. What is the error? Tell me. You should not specify the access modifier in the interface. Why? Because you, by default, the interface is public. We have mentioned public, so you should not require to add the public properties here. Rebuild it. Now it's okay. This is the service 1.svc file where you have implemented the things. Okay. I created a class here itself. Okay. See, I have not created user service. I have just created a classes here itself. I need to add one service, svc file. Okay. So what I can do, okay. Whatever I did, I can paste it here itself. User repository, I'll put it here. or I can do one thing instead of here. Actually, I have to specify there itself, but I didn't. Just replacing the things here. Okay. Copying this thing, then that's it, nothing else. Let's run this project first. Oh. Going to the browser, I already added it. This is the service one. Control app, refresh it. See what error I am getting it. The type of WCF service library dot service one provided as the service attribute value in the service host directive provided in the configuration element, this could not be found. Because if you created a particular service one, the class, or I can make this class as user detail, or leave it as it is. No worry. Okay. But the most important thing, if you can notice it here itself, I have not put it an attribute called service contract. Now let's run it and see there. Nothing but a. Still, I am getting some error because there are some other parameters which I have not mentioned. You can see the browser. Still error. Because if you wanted to expose a method, you have to use a operation contract to exposing the methods. There is one most important thing which you need to understand. Refresh, build it, going to the browser and still bring me an error. The service attribute value in the service host directive provided in the configuration element, this activation could not be found. Still, it is not able to find it. I need to do. Because whenever you are talking about exposing an particular entity, I'm returning the data in the form of user response. The class I'm using a parameter as a user request. You cannot do it until or unless you have not set it a property or attribute called in the top of the class as data contract. Right click on it, resolve this. If you wanted to expose a property of the particular class, you have to use a attribute called a data member. Just copy it, paste it everywhere, wherever it requires. If you wanted to expose a particular property to the client, you have to use a data member. If you wanted to expose a class, you have to use this one. Same way. Copy this one. Paste it here itself. Data member. It is mainly for serialization and deserialization. Classes you wanted to use as a service. Paste. Data members and data contracted. let's see and go and check renaming the file and everything right now. I'm really sorry, I did something wrong. Actually, it should not be here. You wanted to export data contract, right? So data contract always be an interface. Oh, sorry. If you wanted to expose a particular thing to the client, in that case, interface should be a data contract, service contract and the data contract. Sorry, my mistake. Right? It should be an operation contract. I wanted to expose this interface to the client. So make this, if you wanted to expose a particular interface or wanted to expose a particular class to the site, then you have to use a service contract. If you wanted to expose a method to the client, in that case, you have to go with the operation contract. Okay. Service or what? Service library I use, right?